falling before your throne. Oh, we're falling before your throne.
Amen. Let's praise him today. Hey, Pastor.
Amen. All right, well, today we celebrate, or this weekend we celebrate Labor Day, tomorrow being the holiday. And if you didn't know what Labor Day was, Labor Day is a federal holiday celebrated on the first Monday of September to honor and recognize the American labor movement and the works and contribution of laborers to the development and achievements of the United States. There it is, Labor Day. As I was thinking on a sermon, being Labor Day, for those who are still in the workforce, they are confronted every day with this thing of going to work, okay? Which, if you have work, by the way, it's a wonderful thing. If you're a man, of course, that's your one of your first callings. God says that he was put man in the garden to work, so man's first calling is to work. So as you know, I have four daughters, and one of my first things I always tell my daughters is make sure you got a guy who's okay with working, okay? Work is a part of, you know, of who we are as men. So we're to work. So we thank God for the having work and the ability to work. And if you love your job, boy, that's an even greater reason to work, isn't it? If you love your job. But even though you may love your job and are thankful for work, there are days when it's just tough to get up to work, isn't it? Just tough to get up. But you decide that you need to get up for a couple reasons. You need to get up and you need to go to work, even on those days you would rather not, because one motivating factor is you get paid. That's a good motive. Probably if that motivation was gone, we probably wouldn't do it too much, right? So the motivating factor is there, you get paid, and so you go to your job. And the other one, if you want to keep your job, there are two good motivating factors. One, you get paid. The second one is you want to keep your job. And then after you motivate yourself to get up and go to work, then you know there's some days that it's, you know, going in, it's going to be one of those days. You ever have those? It's just one of those days, you know. Co-worker got a hair wrong or something like that. Of course, it's never you, but I mean, it's always them, and there's going to be those days. But that shouldn't surprise us, right? Because Mama said there'd be days like this, and just the way it is. But praise God, for the most part, our days aren't always one of those days. So tomorrow, we enjoy the day off as we celebrate Labor Day. But you know what? We should not just celebrate Labor Day. We should celebrate every day. That's what the Bible tells us. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. You know, I don't care how many days or how many years you live on this earth. It's really broken down to days. Even Methuselah, the man who is recorded in the Bible to have lived the longest, we're told of Methuselah that he lived after he begot Lamech. In the book of Genesis, 782 years, begot sons and daughters. And all the days of Methuselah were 969 years, and he died. So we see that even in mentioning that he was 969 years old, it goes on to say that he, all the days of Methuselah. You understand the importance of the day? We see it in our own, you know, you go into a cemetery, you look at the tombstones, you know how it goes. You got the day of the birth, you got the day of the death, and you, between those you have the dash, and it's what you do on that dash that is all important. So we see every day is to count. In Psalm 90, verse 10, it says, teach us to number our days so that we may apply our hearts to wisdom. The truth be told, we only each have so many days in our lives. We only have so many steps that, you know what, when you reach that last step, the Lord has that date and only he knows about it. And when you reach that last step, then he takes you out. Some he takes home. All right. But there's no guarantee of that unless you're a believer in the Lord Jesus Christ. But the fact is, we only have so many days, and we need to think about those days and use them wisely. You know, we were just really confronted with that this past week. I just did a funeral Thursday, where someone who attended here, they were here Wednesday at prayer meeting, on Saturday, they were gone. It's that quick kind of thing. Wasn't, you know, deathbed or anything like that, but so these things happen, and we talk about it, and it's still shocking, but that's reality. So we're to, you know, apply our hearts to wisdom. Teach us to number our days. Make our days count. You know, time is one of the things that we are to be good stewards of, or caretakers of, because there's only so much time. And as I think of it, and I think about and ponder how I use my time, I want to use it wisely to get the most out of it. Paul the Apostle says that much in Ephesians chapter 5, in verse 14. He says, "Wherefore he saith, awake thou that sleepest, and arise from the dead, and Christ shall give thee light." Now, Paul is talking to believers here, and he's saying it's that we need to awaken. We need to arise out of our sleep. Believers have the ability to really fall into a spiritual stupor. A stupor is just dazed. You're dazed, you know. And he's saying we need to awaken out of that. It's very easy to become dazed and confused in a very confusing world, in a very uncertain time. And that's something that we have to understand. A lot of times with this COVID thing, we don't know, you know, what's happening the next day. We don't know what's happening today. You know, we can plan all these things, and next thing you know, they have some kind of spike, or some kind of governor says, no, you can't do this anymore, and it's closed down. I saw they opened restaurants. That was nice, right? Restaurants were open. Anybody go to a restaurant yet? Yep. I did. Yeah, it was very nice. It was nice. I sat down. The waitress came up. Can I help you? Why, yes, you can. It was very nice. So, again, we don't know what's happening a lot of times. So we get caught in this kind of a funk where, you know, what's going on? And sometimes it gets us to the place where we don't want to do anything. We just kind of keep hitting the snooze button. And Paul's saying it's time to wake up in these days of uncertainty, in these days where there's so much distraction, and the days where there's so much division, where so many things are trying to steal our focus. Paul is saying it's time to shake ourselves out of this spiritual stupor and get walking again. And then he tells believers how they are to walk in verse 15 of Ephesians 5. He says, "See then that you walk circumspectly, that you walk diligently, not as fools, but as wise, redeeming the time, because the days are evil." I like how J. Vernon McGee puts these verses. He says the believer is to walk wisely. His walk is to reveal the urgency of the hour and the importance of living for God. And I'm going to tell you something. If there was ever the urgency of the hour in our lifetime, it is now. Okay, we need to understand the urgency that is out there, and the importance of us as believers living for God. He goes on to say the entire objective in his walk is to stay in the will of God. He walks in the will of God as a train runs on the track. And we know that there's a lot of things trying to derail the Christian, okay? Just this whole thing of us, you know, not being in church together, not seeing one another and things like that. It is divisive. So you'll keep hearing me hound on this. It's time to get back to church. It's time to get back together again. So whether that's an outdoor service for you or an indoor service with a mask, it's time to get back to church. It really is. So as we celebrate Labor Day, it's time to really look and just understand that, you know what, as I was pondering what I'm going to preach on, well, I'm thinking, you know what, just as in the workforce we have to force ourselves sometimes to get up, we got to make that decision to get up and go to work, we are faced with that same decision every day as we labor for the Lord. You know, I got to ask myself, am I going to give the Lord my best today? Understand that there are eternal ramifications when it comes to serving the Lord. You see, on our time on earth right now, what we do here on earth right now will determine our future reward. Now, don't misunderstand me. I'm talking to believers here, okay? A believer is one who's already placed their faith in the completed work of Christ. They understand that you're only saved by grace through faith, that it's not of works. Good works cannot save you. They never have, and they never will. The Bible tells us that good works are not accepted by God as payment for sin. The only payment God accepts is the payment Jesus made for us on the cross. It's that payment we're going to celebrate today when we have communion together as we remember that price that he paid. But good works can't save us, so don't misunderstand what I'm saying. But once a person is saved, once a person has placed their faith in the completed work of Christ alone, we are then called to serve the Lord. As believers, we are saved unto good works. You know, when they talk about, James talks about you're saved by works and Paul says you're saved by faith, they're talking about the same thing, just different instances, okay? Paul is saying you're saved by faith. James says that faith that saves you works, that's all. And it should. It should show itself in the things we do. The Bible says right after that we're saved by grace through faith, that not of works, lest any man should boast. And then he says, for we are his workmanship created unto good works, that we should walk in them. That God has prepared a course for each of our lives. And guess what? Your course is different than my course. And you are told that you need to run your course, as I'm told that I need to run my course, okay? That's our job, to run the race. And understand this, what we do here as believers will determine, one, what we're going to be doing during the millennial reign, when Christ reigns on the throne for 1,000 years after the rapture of the church and the tribulation. Then you're going to have the millennial reign of Christ, where he's going to reign on this earth for 1,000 years. And we're told that we will rule and reign with him, okay? Depending on how faithful we are in what he gives us to do now. So it doesn't matter whether you're a pastor or whether you're clean in the church. It's a matter of, are you faithful in that? So if I'm a slackered pastor, but man, you're a great cleaner, guess what? You're going to have a greater rule and reign because you were faithful in what he gave you than me. Do you understand how it goes? God is fair and God is just. So what we do here is just a proving ground for what we're going to do when we rule and reign with Christ during the millennial reign. And it also will determine the rewards that we will receive at the judgment seat of Christ. So if we're wise, we would invest in our future. Now, some people understand this on the physical realm. You know, we do the Dave Ramsey Financial Peace University course. It's a great course. And it teaches that, you know, how you live now, if you do the right things now, then in your future, then you could really live. And there are many who've invested in their future in the physical world, and because they did, they were able to retire early. And then there's others who didn't, or just kept having kids, so they were old, one or the other. I think that'll do it to you, too. But, you know, maybe they would like to retire, but because of different things, they're on the work to your dead plan. That happens. They didn't invest well into the future. So it's a wonderful thing if you've invested into your future and you are able to retire and live off the fruits of your labor. That's a wonderful thing. But it seems like while we get that and while we understand that in the physical realm, we seem to miss that in the spiritual realm. Yet Jesus tells us to invest in our spiritual future. He says this, lay up not for yourself treasures upon the earth, where moth and rust does corrupt and where thieves break through and steal, but lay up for yourself treasures in heaven, where neither moth nor rust does corrupt and where thieves do not break through nor steal, for where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. Now understand, Jesus is not saying don't invest in your financial future while here on earth. What he's saying is don't let that be your priority. Prioritize in the spiritual. Prioritize in investing in your heavenly bank account, because it's your heavenly bank account that it says moths aren't going to come in, it's never going to rot away, and nobody could steal it from you. And the return of the investment, by the way, is far greater than anything here on earth. You see, that's what Jesus is saying. He wants our lives to center around him. He wants our focus to be on heaven and on those things that are permanent and those things that are eternal, because they're the things that are going to last. So let me ask you, if we were able to look at our heavenly bank account, what would it look like? So I could look at my earthly bank account. I got an app, you know, TD Bank. I go on my app and I could see, you know, where things are or where they aren't, and I could go through them, okay? But the question is, what does our heavenly bank account look like? Too bad that we don't have an app for that, right? Or maybe that's good we don't have an app for that. But it's going to be revealed to us at the judgment seat of Christ. But what are we doing now to invest into the future? I mean, what would it look like? You know, as we make our way through Corona here, we as Christians, we can find ourselves maybe where we've stopped investing in the eternal because we find ourselves in this spiritual stupor, you know, just walking around in kind of a daze of, okay, what's next? What's going on? What are we supposed to be doing? I mean, it's had a great effect on the working of the church. You know, in leading the church, you're leading a mostly volunteer workforce. There's this small paid staff, but by and large, the work of the church through the ministries of the church is done by volunteer staff. These volunteers arise up because the Lord has stirred something in their heart and they've responded to what the Lord has laid upon their heart. And they either begin a ministry that hasn't been there or they join in a ministry. But again, mostly done on a volunteer basis. So as we look to reopen the church, as we look to get the ministries going again, there's a lot of things that have to come into place, okay? And we will begin working again. Matter of fact, it's so much stuff between, you got to clean this, got to clean that, got to do this, got to have that. We're going to start metering things because, you know, like I said, MOPS wants to start and Heritage Girls want to start and Trail Life wants to start, Awana's starting. But because of all this, the only numbers here and that many numbers there and so many can fit here, there's a lot of stuff that has to go in it, just the way it is. So we're going to start metering it and get it going. But one of the things that I ponder is, you know, how are we going to respond as a church? Are we going to be ready to go back to work? Now, I say this knowing that there are some people who are heading up ministries that they are chomping at the bit and they're ready to go. As soon as that, you know, as soon as you hear they're off, they're ready to jump into it. I like that mentality. That's an exciting thing, you know. And my job as a pastor, I'm not a micromanager. I just look to be a support group. It's their ministry. They need to run it the way they see fit. And we're there to support them any way they can. But again, there's those who are ready. And then there's others who maybe COVID has affected them in a different way. My concern is for those who have grown comfortable and complacent in COVID. I mean, most ministries have been shut down, at least since March. And folks who were once involved in ministry have been forced to sit back and wait. So they haven't been busy about the Lord's business because, again, basically it's been shut down. And now to get going again seems like a daunting task. It's always tough to get going again, isn't it? Because it's very easy to get comfortable in doing nothing. Did you know that? It's easy to get comfortable in doing nothing. You know, getting started is the hardest thing. It really is. If we're honest with ourselves, sometimes it's difficult to start again. You know, and I get that. I get that. You know, I've been faced with that. Let me tell you something. Some people know, some people don't know. I've had a sprinkler business for 40 years. Interesting thing about a lawn sprinkler business. You're off from a few weeks before December till April. You're off. You know, I've downsized the business quite a bit, but you are off. And in that shutdown time between Christmas and April, it's very wonderful. You know, it's a wonderful thing. I'm getting up in the morning. I'm like it's kind of like, you know, I still work with the church, of course, but it frees all that up. So I could get up in the morning and I have my cup of coffee. Isn't that nice? It's almost like, you know, those commercials where you hold a cup like this. Don't they make coffee look good? The best part of waking up is Folgers in your cup. I love that. And so I just want to hold my warm cup. You know, I get to turn on the computer. You know, I read and study there. It's nice. I've always studied with noise in the background, so I got the TV on, my favorite news channel is on, and I get that time to chill, and I also get time to do the honey-do list, which has grown considerably from April till December. That list doesn't change. So I get to do that kind of stuff from, you know, mid-December till start of April. But about mid-March, towards the end of March, I know that is about to end. And I start thinking to myself, how am I going to do this again? You know what I mean? And every year it gets harder, by the way. Do you know, as you get older, it gets harder? You know, there was a comedian one time, that's what he said. It's like, we're like those old cars, we're trying to start on a cold day. Remember, you ever hear that? He turns the key in and you hear the car go, please don't try to start me. You know, you know, leave me alone. You know, that's what I kind of feel like. This is getting harder and harder all the time. And it does get harder. It does get harder. But the fact is, you got to get moving again. You wonder, how's it all going to fit in? But you got to get started again. So what do? You start at a little bit at a time, and you start getting back on track, and things start falling into place. Starting again is the hardest part. Kind of like working out. You know, here in Jersey, gyms have reopened. The planet is open. The no judgment zone. You're not judged unless you don't have a mask. Then you're judged. But other than that, you know, and anyone who exercises knows that when you begin working out again after a layoff, there's a lot of pain. It hurts getting back. You're using muscles that haven't been used. You know, you get done because you're thinking you could jump right back into it. And then for a week, please don't touch me there. You're just like hurting everywhere, right? Anybody have that experience? You know, it's amazing that as you get older, what you find, it takes, you know, you're working out, you're building up, and then you stop, and it doesn't just go like this. It just goes, it's just, you fall off this cliff for some reason. I mean, it's been closed for 6 months. 6 months ago. 6 months ago, think about it, I was a well-honed specimen, all right? Or a specimen of some nature. And now, 6 months later, you know, I got to get back at it again. You know how hard it is to change an O into a V? It's very difficult. You're always in shape, I say. It just depends on what that shape is, right? So I got to get back again. So what do? You start back and you start going a little bit at a time till the soreness wears away and you get back into it. You start to manage your time better. This is what has to happen. Well, let me tell you something. What happens in the physical realm also is true in the spiritual realm. The glaring difference between the two is in the physical realm, you see results. You go back to work, you make more money. You go to the gym, this vitality, energy creates energy, starts kicking in. But sometimes in ministry, it's a different story. You know, in ministry, a lot of times you don't see instant results. Ministry is there for the long haul. Bible says that. You don't plant a seed and look the next day and see growth. You know, ministry is one of those things, it takes a long time. Sometimes you wonder if you're ever going to see results. That's just the way it is. But also, what we have to understand in ministry, even though we may not see a lot of results on this physical plane, I mean, you do have the joy of serving. There is a joy. Jesus, when he washed the disciples' feet, what did he say? He goes, listen, as I've done to you, do to each other. Happier are you if you do these things. So there is a joy in serving. I'm telling you, one of the key things, if you're a miserable Christian, then look at your life and see if you're serving, okay? Because usually the most, am I supposed to say that? I don't know if I'm supposed to say this or not, so this could be dangerous, but usually, the ones who are the most miserable and complain the most are the ones who do nothing. Okay? Just the way it is. Because they got time to point out every flaw. The ones that are busy are running for the Lord. I guess I was supposed to say that. So that's good. Hope I said it nice. I love you all. Anyway. But there is also reward on the other side. You see, I know we live a life that says seeing is believing, but as Christians, we're called to walk by faith and not by sight. So for us, when it comes to spiritual treasure, we're asked to believe that it's there without seeing it. Now, of course, God in his word gives us assurances that there will be these rewards there. He says in Revelation 22:12, behold, I come quickly and my reward is with me to give every man according as his work shall be. He's talking to believers. He says that we're going to be blessed. It says in 1 Corinthians 15:58, therefore, my beloved brethren, be ye steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, for as much as you know that your labor is not in vain in the Lord. It's not in vain what we're doing. It says in Hebrews 6:10, for God is not unrighteous to forget your work and labor of love, which you have showed toward his name, in that you've ministered to the saints and do minister. We got to remember that as we are ministering, and serving, whether it's the believer or the unbeliever. Listen, the unbeliever, God has left the church here to be the hands and feet of Jesus Christ to a lost world, to a world that needs to see and feel the love of Christ, okay? One of these things we're doing with this culture shock thing is to be able to have an answer. Notice at the end it says to not answer with heat, but with love. How do we have an answer? We're the hands and feet of Christ, but as we minister to the world, as we minister to the other, we are also ministering to the Lord. It was interesting when I was doing the, when I'm doing the book of Judges, you know, they were called into a war. They were called all the tribes to go and fight. And I like it. It said one of the tribes, they, I think it was Reuben, the tribe of Reuben, considered it deeply. And then they did nothing. They considered it though. Other tribe just said, we're not going. All right, I like that. Reuben was like, let me think about it, and maybe I'll just wait till the thought passes. That's like me in Planet Fitness, you know. I'm thinking about working out. If I wait long enough, the thought will pass. But listen to this. So these tribes went into battle, but these other tribes stayed behind. And as I read this, I found it interesting because after the victory where Barak and Deborah were being praised for leading them into battle, it says, curse ye Meroz, said the angel of the Lord. Curse ye bitterly the inhabitants thereof, because they came not to help the Lord. Isn't that something? Here's the creator God who spoke everything into existence, who could wipe out everything out of existence, but he chose for people to work alongside of him. And he says, you didn't come to my help. Isn't that something? And he could do that right now, but you know what? He's chosen the church in this church age to be his ministers in this world, to come alongside of him in this time. So we need to take that seriously. So today, as we celebrate Labor Day, I want to encourage some that if you're working, man, keep working. It's worth it. And to others, I just want to arouse to awaken out of our sleep because it's time to get back to work. That if we become comfortable in COVID, it's time to awaken out of our sleep. It's time to get back to work. And serving the Lord is, if serving the Lord is no longer a priority for you, because other priorities have taken your place, his place. Because listen, service is a form of worship. I know we think this is the worship service when they're singing, but that's one form of worship, worshiping God, the fruit of our lips, giving praise to his name. But service is also a worship. When Jesus was told to bow before Satan, he said, you know, I'm not going to bow before you. He says, you worship the Lord your God only, and him shall you serve. So serving the Lord is a form of worship. We have to understand that. So it's time to get back to work because we are saved to serve. We're saved to serve. And if we aren't serving him, here's the deal. If we're not serving the Lord, worshiping the Lord through service, we will find something to take that place. Okay? Because here's what happens. We were created with this knowledge of worshiping God. God has placed eternity in our hearts. So that's why, you know, missionaries could go out to the deepest jungle and they're worshiping the sun, they're worshiping the moon, they're worshiping the stars, they're worshiping the trees, the animals, they're worshiping whatever because this idea of worship is put inside them. So if we're not worshiping God, we will find something else to worship. Yeah, look at the children of Israel. They were delivered great, you know, through the Red Sea opens, they're delivered. Moses goes and receives the commandments 40 days he's away. They're like, I guess Moses ain't coming back. Aaron, make us a golden calf. We need something to worship. We got to worship something. I'm telling you right now, if we are not worshiping the Lord, we will find something to take his place. It's just part of this human nature. Now, I know we don't have golden calves necessarily, that, you know, not statues. But sometimes, you know what? We have golden calves that come in the form of jobs, they come in the form of relationships, they come in the form of pleasure. And none of those things are wrong in themselves. It's great to have great relationships. It's great to have a good job and to love your job. It's great to have pleasure. Yesterday I got to ride the waves, man. I was at Ocean City riding waves. Man, there were great waves. The water was warm. Sun was, that was a beautiful day. Beautiful. Praise the Lord. Good waves, no sharks. That's a great thing, right? It's okay to enjoy those things. But if they start taking priority over God, then we're out of order. I'm out of order. It's just the way it is. We're saved with this great salvation. We're translated from, you know, we're taken from this kingdom of darkness and translated into the kingdom of Jesus Christ. And we're to serve him. He's our king. We're his servants. And we're to be busy about his business, especially as we see his day approaching. Again, this isn't always an easy thing to do. And in Americanized Christianity, and the more I start watching about Americanized Christianity, it shows how far out of whack the Christian message has gotten in America. In America, American Christianity is all about what makes us happy and what fulfills us. There's some things I've seen in what they call church, and I'm looking, I'm saying, is this really what's happening in church? It's crazy stuff going on. You see, I'm thinking Americanized Christianity is far different than biblical Christianity. You see, because I read that Jesus says, if any man will come after me, let him deny himself, take up his cross, and follow me. That's what I read Jesus say. Sure seems different in Americanized Christianity. Americanized Christianity is what's in it for me. And Jesus is saying, no, it's a total different thing. So as we take this Labor Day weekend, why don't we use it as a stepping stone to readjust our focus on laboring for the Lord? Because it's very easy to be led off course. We are prone to wander. There are so many distractions. Let us take this time to refocus on the Lord and how we're serving him. You know, in Luke chapter 9, if you want to turn there, in verse 51, Jesus is about to go to the cross. Luke chapter 9, verse 51. Interesting thing. And I think it speaks to us in what I'm talking about today. It says, and it came to pass when the time was come that he should be received up, talking about Jesus being, you know, gone to the cross and rising again, being taken up. Notice what he did. He steadfastly set his face to go to Jerusalem. I think this is important to see at this time in the earthly ministry of Jesus. He steadfastly set his face to go to Jerusalem. That meant that, you know, he's so focused on the mission for which he came that he wasn't going to allow distractions to take him off the course that the Father set for him. Jesus came to save sinners, and it was going to take a cross to do that. So he set his face on what the Father had given him to do. You know, in the prophecy about Jesus, it says this in Isaiah 50, verse 7, for the Lord God will help him, therefore shall I not be confounded. Listen to what he says. Therefore have I set my face like a flint, and I know I shall not be ashamed. Jesus kept his eyes on the mark. Jesus kept his eyes on his calling. I like how Warren Wiersbe says this. He says this, keep in mind that when Jesus Christ was ministering on earth, he had to live by faith even as we must today. He did not use his divine power selfishly for himself, but trusted God and depended on the power of the Spirit. You see, Jesus was 100% God, 100% man. The things that were happening to him, it's not like, you know, oh, well, that happened to Jesus. Well, he's God. No, he put his glory aside, and what was happening to him was really happening to him. So that's why in the Garden of Gethsemane, as he's pressed down by everything that's going on, as he's going to the cross and he sweats droplets of blood, it's because of the pressure that he felt as a man. He went through all these things. So he's this example for us who are his followers. You see, he would never call his disciples to do something without setting the example first. It says he set his face towards Jerusalem. He was locked in like a flint. He wasn't going to be moved from the course that the Father gave him. And like I said earlier, we were all given a course. But too often we get distracted. We turn to the left, we turn to the right, and we're all over the place. In these times that we're in, especially, we need to keep our focus for what God has for us. We need to keep our focus. Let me tell you something. So the first thing that's going to be necessary is going to be self-denial. If any man will come after me, let him deny himself. You see, take up his cross and follow me. Again, Jesus set the example. He said, my meat is to do the will of him that sent me and to finish the work. Today, communion, we're reminded that because Jesus finished his course, our salvation is secured. We've been forgiven. We've been given this free gift of everlasting life. We've been called to serve him, not to earn heaven, not to even earn his favor, because the Bible says we're already accepted in the beloved. But we're serving him in appreciation for what he did for us. Two of the verses I love, 2 Corinthians 5:14. If you would turn there, you've heard me preach this before, 2 Corinthians 5:14. And I think, you know, it's funny because I hear people say this all the time, you know, he's always preaching the gospel. I've heard people say, I feel like I got to get saved every week, you know. I preach the gospel, and I'll tell you why. One, because, you know what, you never know who's saved here and who's not. I know there's people in church here. It doesn't mean they're saved, number one. Number two, it's the greatest message. It's still the power of God, the salvation to all who believe. Okay, number three, you know what? I love to hear the gospel. I love to hear the gospel. Because you know what the gospel reminds me of? This great salvation I have. That unworthy as I am, God was merciful to send his son to die for my sins. I need to be reminded of that. I need communion to remind me of that. Because God is good, and all glory goes to him and to him alone. And it's that, when I remember this, it kind of reminds me here what Paul says, that it says, for the love of Christ constraineth us. The love of Christ compels us. This is the thing that moves us forward. Because we thus judge that if one died for all, then we were all dead. We were all dead in sin. And there was nothing we could do to save ourselves. And that he died for all, then they which live should not henceforth live unto themselves, but unto him which died for them and rose again. You understand? He's saying if you've gotten saved, if you've been brought from the death of your sin, and you've been given this free gift of everlasting life because of what Christ did, then it says you're no longer to be living for yourself. You're to be living for him. And why? Out of appreciation. You did this for me. What can I do for you? That should compel us. Especially, let me tell you something. As the longer you're saved, bear witness with me on this. The longer you're saved and the more God reveals you to you, isn't his grace more amazing? It never lessens. Been saved 20, 30 years. Are you kidding me, Lord? I thought I was shot out when you saved me. Now you've been revealing me to me for the last 20, 30 years. And you knew all this ahead of time and you still did that? Are you kidding me? If that doesn't get you fired up, let me tell you something. You might be dead. You might be dead. Or at least asleep, man. Pull your mask and get a breath. But I'm telling you, just the way it is. He says, this love constrains us. That, Lord, you're going, not only did you die for me, but you love me this much. Even on my worst day, you still love me. Amen. Let me tell you something. It's time that we awaken out of our sleep. It's time we shake off the cobwebs. It's time we stop living for ourselves. It's time we stop living in fear. And you know what? It's time that we start living for him who loved us so much to die for us. We're reminded of this today in communion. I'd say, you know what? It's time that we recommit to him. As we're about to open up ministries again and get back on course, it's time that we start getting back on course and get busy serving the Lord again. And I don't know what that looks like in your life. You know, that's between you and God. But there are a boatload of ways to serve here. You know, you're old and tired. Well, listen, we need prayer. So we got people praying on Tuesday mornings. You got people praying on Friday mornings. You got people praying on Wednesday nights. You can pray when you want. We need people to pray for this ministry. We need to pray for one another. There's ministries where you could serve. There's things to do. If we're going to be the hands and feet of Christ, we need everybody on board, especially in these times. So I don't know what you're doing, but I'll tell you right now, we are called to live a life where we are not just saved, but we're saved to serve. And what an honor it is to serve alongside the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Let me tell you something, this is the truth of it. Jesus is always calling us into a deeper relationship with him. He's always calling us deeper. I don't care if you've been saved 30, 40 years. He's calling us into a deeper relationship with him. And let me tell you, when discipleship is not easy. Walking alongside of Jesus is not always easy. It's not a bed of roses. It's not always a constant success. It's not always prosperity. It will take, you know what, using time that you want for you to be used for him. Sometimes it's like that. It takes, sometimes it's not convenient. God hits a moving target. Man, I'd love to save the Lord. Let me consider it. But, you know, I'm busy. You know what? God hits moving targets. You know why? To really see where your heart is. Are you willing to put things aside so that you'll serve him? So you may be thinking it's too hard or you just don't have it in you. Listen to me. God will never call you into something that he hasn't already equipped you for. So the choice is yours. But the Christian life is not always easy. There's twists, there's turns. Sometimes it could be downright scary. I love the one verse that says this, of the apostles, the disciples, it says they were amazed and afraid. All in one verse, and I think that sums up the Christian life. That we are amazed and afraid. A few years ago, let me close with this story. A few years ago, we were camping near Harper's Ferry. Right, it was Harper's Ferry, right? And right at Harper's Ferry, we have two rivers. Coming together. We have the Shenandoah, right, and the Potomac. I'm looking at Mike because they were with us. Shenandoah and the Potomac. And they said, you have a choice because we were going to go down the river. If you take the Shenandoah, it's the lazy river. You get in your tube, you just float down, there's somebody there, picks you up, it's all good. Or you have the Potomac, whitewater. They give you an oar. So you can navigate through the white water. So I chose the Shenandoah. I'm just floating. That's all I want to do is float down the river. Get in my tube, kick back, enjoy the weather, float. What they didn't tell me was there was a very strong wind in my face that day. I got my tube, and guess what happened? My tube started going the wrong way. What I thought was going to be an easy float down the river was a nightmare. Do you remember that? I'm laying on my tube and I'm trying to swim down. These were my oars. Right? Trying to swim down. After that got tired, I'm laying on my back and I'm trying to kick my way down. We worked out a way to kick down. You know, they took the white water, doing all that kind of stuff. It was like, you see people going and it's like, it was a nightmare. What promised to be an easy ride was a nightmare. They were there way before us. Should have gone the whitewater way. They were there before us. They were sitting back just relaxing. While I got nothing left in me. After that, you're kind of just, you're shot. Let me tell you something. There is an illustration in this, believe it or not. You know, as we go through life, a lot of times the Lord is calling us to serve him, and we're thinking his way is too hard, it's too treacherous, so we want to take the lazy way. But you know what you find with the lazy way? You're doing a lot of work, and you're getting no results. But when you take God's way, it may be some treachery, it may be some excitement, you may not know how it's going to get done. But I'll tell you right now, what you got when you take God's way is the current taking you. You see, that's what grace is. Grace gives us this. He empowers us to get where we got to be. And you know what? The ride is exciting. So the choice is ours. Are we ready to get back to work? I'm going to tell you something. If you choose to say yes, be in for an exciting ride, especially in these times we're in. It will be an exciting ride because you know what? We got a world out there that is hungry right now, and they're looking for truth. And we have that message of Jesus Christ. There's Christians who are hurting that need ministering to now. Ministry, I'm not saying it's always easy. I think one of them got stuck on a log and, you know, there was all that excitement. But you know what? In the end, it was, they could look back and say, man, wasn't it exciting this way and this way and this way? And I believe that, you know what, when we get with Jesus, some of the things that you do when you serve with people are some of the things you talk about forever. Remember when this happened? Remember when that happened? Man, this could only be God. Do you remember when God used us for this or for that? And one day we're going to be with Jesus. And we'll be able to share those stories. And he'll be saying, you know what? I was right in the boat with you. But you don't find that when you just want to float down the lazy river. That's Christianity living for yourself. You're struggling. You're trying to get by. And you know what? You don't have that same joy. You don't have that same abundant life. You don't have that same vibrancy of life because you chose the easy way. So I'm saying for all the folks here today, for all you folks online, it's time to get working again. God has a great future for us. We need to invest in it. If you're not compelled, I don't know what could compel you. Maybe this time of communion. You know, in communion, we have this time where we go before the Lord. The Bible tells us that we are to judge ourselves. And a lot of times we confess our sins, you know, I committed this and I committed that and I committed this and that. And that's right and we should and we need to. But there's also those sins of omission that you know that God is calling you to serve in some way. Where that is, that's between you and God, but you know it. And the Bible says, for him who knows to do right and doesn't do it, to him it is sin. I think usually we're more guilty of sins of omission. That God is calling us to serve, God is calling us to witness, God is calling us different things, and we keep putting it off. We keep giving excuses. So as we go to communion today, as believers, and I think we're going to pass out the elements now, as believers, let's go before the Lord and really confess our sins. Lord, I've been sitting back. You know what? I've become complacent in COVID. And I've just been taking the easy route. It's time for me to get back. And I'll tell you right now, God will give you what you need. My prayer for the church is that we would have a fresh wind and a fresh fire, that he would stir our hearts even more so as we see his day approaching. If you are a non-believer here, really communion is for believers. We are sharing that which we have in common. Our commonality with Christ is we are sinners, but he became sin for us. He took our sin upon himself. That's what we're remembering today. And that he paid for that sin with his own blood. And if you place your faith in what he did alone, then you're forgiven of that sin. You're given this free gift of everlasting life. So if you've never done that, why don't you take that time now, whether you're in this room today or whether you're online, why don't you take this time now and just say, Lord, I know I'm a sinner. But I believe that on that cross, Jesus died for me, paying for my sins. And I believe that he is the only way to be forgiven, to be given this free gift of everlasting life. I'm asking you to forgive me of my sins, and I'm asking Jesus Christ to come into my life to be my Savior and Lord. Maybe that's your prayer today. The Bible says, if today you hear his voice, harden not your hearts. Why don't you ask the Lord to save you? Again, for us as believers, as the elements are being passed out, if you already have yours, why don't you go before the Lord now? And just say, Lord, I believe that you have something for me to do. And I've been putting it off. I've been pushing it aside. But I want to start being busy about your business. And let him lead you in that. Let him guide you in that. Whatever that would be. He's just calling us to be faithful in whatever that thing is. So we're going to take a few moments here. Steve, I need one up here too. We're going to take a few moments. And then we'll have this time of communion. Jesus, for I have received of the Lord that which also I delivered unto you, that the Lord Jesus, the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread. When he had given thanks, he brake it and said, take, eat, this is my body, which is broken for you. This do in remembrance of me. Here we have this communion bread and symbolizing the body of Christ, that he would take our sin upon himself, that he would take God's wrath because of sin upon himself so we could be pardoned. So we remember him giving his body, taking that beating for us so that we could be set free. We ask your blessing on this bread. We pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. Take, eat, remembering him. After the same manner also he took the cup when he had supped, saying, this cup is the new testament in my blood. This do you as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you do show the Lord's death until he comes. Father, again, we thank you for this cup, symbolic of the blood of Jesus, the precious blood that paid for our sin, that washes us clean. Father, we thank you for the blood of Jesus. By his stripes, we've been healed. We ask your blessing on this cup. We pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. Father, we thank you for this time of communion, a time, a great time as we end the summer, start the September, starting the ministries again. We start off with communion to remember the work you did for us, the price you paid for us. And Father, I pray that for each of us, just thinking about what you did for us, that we were dead in trespasses and sin, that you would give your son to die for us. When we consider the work of Jesus, that it would compel us to serve you with a zeal, a fervency, an urgency that is not in us. I pray that you would stir the hearts of your people, Lord, to step up again, to serve, to get back on track again, working the ministry so that in this place you are glorified, your name is magnified, and that people will be drawn to you for your great gift of salvation. So, Father, I pray you would stir the hearts of your people. Give us a fresh wind and a fresh fire. Give us a new vision. And I pray that we would respond by setting our eyes steadfast upon you and upon the work that you have for us, that we would run our course well and run it to the finish line. We pray and we ask this all in Jesus' name. Amen. We're going to close with one last song today.